A lot of people in sentence correction start by looking at the answer choices. They just kind of glance at the answer choices, look at the split, right? What, you know, usually there's like a 3-to-2 split in the beginnings of the answer choices, and a lot of folks start with that before they even read the original sentence. In fact, I used to teach that that was the right way to do it, because that's the way Manhattan Prep teaches it. So I actually used to teach the glance. What I realized over the years of teaching that is that the glance probably hurts more than it helps. And here's why. When you glance at the answer choices ahead of time and look at that split, psychologically, you already are kind of feeling obligated to decide, to make a decision on that split. But I've seen a lot of official GMAT questions where that split at the beginning of the answer choices is a distraction, meaning both sides of the split are fine. And it's actually later on in the answer choices that the real decisions have to come in. But when you feel obligated to make a choice, and maybe you're not sure which one is right, because it turns out they're both fine, then you end up eliminating some of the answer choices, one of which may very well be the right answer. And so then you're already off to a bad start. I think on top of that, if you did the glance ahead of time and then read the original answer choice, you're a bit distracted now, because already, you know, part of your processing power is still thinking about that split that you noticed in your glance, and that's distracting from what you should be doing at that point, which is thinking deeply about the sentence. Why is the author writing this thing? What is his or her point? What's the subject and what's the verb? And what's kind of the general structure of this sentence? So my advice now is don't do the glance. Like don't even look at the answer choices ahead of time. Just go ahead and read the original sentence with a focus on what drove the author to write this sentence. And that goes hand in hand with a structural analysis, a subject-verb analysis, because the author's motivation for writing the sentence won't be revealed in the modifiers. The purpose of the sentence is in the main clause, in the subject and the verb. So by focusing on the purpose of the sentence, it kind of helps us better identify the subject and the verb, which of course is an important thing for sentence correction. So that's what I would do when I first see a sentence correction question, is I would read the original sentence and focus on subject, verb, and purpose, which again go hand in hand. The other thing that I'll focus on, and this is different from how most people do it, most people, when they read the original sentence, they're more focused on the underlined text. Because they're thinking, the underlined text is the part that we're being tested on. The underlined text is the part on which we have to make decisions. But it turns out that that's the wrong approach. It's actually better to focus on the non-underlined text. And here's why. The underlined text, that's just answer choice A. That's just 1 out of 5 answer choices. The non-underlined text, that goes with all 5 answer choices. So mathematically speaking, the non-underlined text is 5 times as important as the underlined text. What's more is that the GMAT will put in hints in the non-underlined text to let us know what the underlined text should look like. For example, the subject will be underlined and the verb won't be underlined, or vice versa. So the non-underlined part determines whether that underlined part should be plural or singular. Same thing with pronouns. Maybe the pronoun is underlined but the antecedent is not, or vice versa. So again, you need to refer to the non-underlined part to figure out what the underlined part should look like. So the GMAT does that a lot, and I've noticed that as the questions get harder, they'll have a non-underlined text at the end of the sentence containing all the hints. And why is that harder? Because people tend to either stop reading when they get to the end of the underline, or even if they do keep reading, they kind of lose their focus at that point. They're not too concerned about that non-underlined chunk of text at the end, because they figure the underlined part is what I'm being tested on, so you know I don't really need to read or pay attention to that last part at the end. And so the GMAT will put those hints in that last non-underlined chunk of text to make it harder. So the two big takeaways here are, number one, start by looking at the original sentence, don't glance at the answer choices, and focus on the subject verb slash purpose of the sentence. And takeaway number two, put more of your attention on the non-underlined text than you do on the underlined text. From there, my approach is probably similar to most people, meaning I'll go to the answer choices. If I already noticed a mistake in the original sentence, then I'll use that to see which answer choices can I eliminate, which answer choices repeat that mistake, and then narrow it down from there and go based on my confidence level. So if I find an issue, a split on something that I'm very confident on, I'll start with that. And then I'll kind of work my way down in terms of my confidence level with the rest of the splits. So that's my advice for sentence correction. If you found this video useful, go to quantreasoning.com for a lot more where that came from. You should also click that like button and let me know in the comments below what you'd like me to make future videos about. And of course, if you haven't yet subscribed, go ahead and do that and click that bell below so you get notified about future videos. See you next time.